Welcome to this micro edition of the PoJo Show. I'm your host, Jedediah Smith. In this episode, my subject is a remembrance of Sam Hamill, poet, translator, publisher. I'll be playing Hamill reading a couple of his own poems. I'll also include poems by Gary Snyder and Kenneth Rexroth, two compatriots and fellow travelers on the road of poetry that led back and forth from the West Coast to Asia. On the full-length Pojo shows, my co-host Batty Royale and I explore a poetry topic in depth, playing recorded poetry for about an hour. In these micro shows, I just play a few recordings of poets reading their work in short sessions of about 15 minutes. Hamill, who lived from 1943 to 2018, was the co-founder of Copper Canyon Press, one of the great independent presses for poetry, and he was also well known for initiating the Poets Against War movement in response to the Iraq War. Maybe a less quantifiable fact about Hamill was that he was a luminescent presence on Facebook in his last years. At last count, he had about 4,600 friends there, and while many do bump up against that 5,000 limit, Sam really engaged people. He engaged everyone. He fostered what can only be called a salon of poetry, politics, and slow, careful thought and conversation in a medium best known for slogans, for memes, for rudeness. Under his guidance, people shared, courteously or else, knowledge, titles, authors, events, and Sam's own insights. I was always unduly pleased when he liked or shared something I had contributed. It meant more to me than most editors' acceptances of my poetry submissions over the years. So like many readers and friends, I can't help but remember Sam, so I decided to share this remembrance with you. The spark for creating this episode was the arrival on my doorstep of Hamill's translation of Matsuo Bashō's Narrow Road to the Interior, a 1702 work known in part as one of the origins of the haibun form, which links prose and haiku. As a reader and writer of haibun, I've been wanting this book for a while. I'm not sure why it took me so long to get it. It's the genesis work of that particular form and just a major text of Japanese literature in general. And this is a great collection that he's put together since it has several more works by Bashō: Travelogue of Weather-Beaten Bones, The Knapsack Notebook, and Sarashina Travelogue. Plus, it has 250 of his standalone haiku, so what more could you ask for? Now, my subject is not Bashō, but Hamill. Still, I would like to include some of Sam's scholarship and translation, so I'll read the beginning haibun from Narrow Road to the Interior in this episode. And in doing so, I'll call into question, or call into complication, if you will, a statement often made about Bashō and haiku and Asian poetry as a whole. But that's for a little later. First, I'd like to play one of Hamill's original poems. In 2000, he released an album called Heart of Bamboo, Poetry and Music in the Zen Tradition. On it, he reads poems and translations to music of the shakuhachi, played by Christopher Yomei Blostel, and koto, played by Elizabeth Falconer. In one of the essays included with the CD, Hamill writes, "The roots of poetry inevitably return us to music. All poetry aspires to the condition of music. Poetry and music share a common root. Both begin in deep listening." The selection I'll play from that album is entitled Midsummer, and it concerns one of Hamill's great themes, bringing nature back to the domestic world, in this case, through an encounter with two deer.
Thank you. Two yearling deer stood in heavy falling mist in the middle of the road leading into town, brown coats glistening, huge eyes open wide, caught in the headlights, in the first yellowish smear of coming daybreak. Twenty feet away, I finally stopped the car and sat still inside, eyes locked together in a curious searching with those of the doe. Minute by minute, we were transfixed, motionless, each imagining the other. And then the sun peeled back the dark clouds like a second skin. And in unison, the deer stepped slowly forward, gently, cautiously, off the road into underbrush that flourishes along the wood's edge, and vanished in mist. Dazed, I returned to my day, to the work at hand. And now, the hour late in the morning, mist falling again, I can still feel my skin prickle under those beautiful brown doe eyes, touching me like a lover's hand, cautious, slowly exploring something deep in me I cannot touch or name.
The moon and sun are eternal travelers. Even the years wander on, a lifetime adrift in a boat, or in old age leading a tired horse into the years. Every day is a journey, and the journey itself is home. From the earliest times, there have always been some who perished along the road. Still, I have always been drawn by wind-blown clouds into dreams of a lifetime of wandering. Coming home from a year's walking tour of the coast last autumn, I swept the cobwebs from my hut on the banks of the Sumida just in time for New Year. But by the time the spring mists began to rise from the fields, I longed to cross the Shirakawa barrier into the northern interior. Drawn by the wanderer spirit, Dosojin, I couldn't concentrate on things. Mending my cotton pants, sewing a new strap on my bamboo hat, I daydreamed. Rubbing moxa into my legs to strengthen them, I dreamed a bright moon rising over Matsushima. So I placed my house in another's hands and moved to my patron, Mr. Sampu's summer house in preparation for my journey. And I left a verse by my door. Even this grass hut may be transformed into a doll's house.
perfect half moon glistens in the mist high over the young bamboo. The smoke stained glass I watch it through makes a perfect halo around it as though the moon were full. Below, the trees are doubly dark, where no breeze lifts a leaf. Nothing moves that doesn't move towards sleep. You move in another room into the dreamtime world, your hair flooding out in soft waves around your face. The night is so perfectly still, I can hear your every breath above my beating heart. The fire's long since gone out. Alone by my lamp, I read Rexroth's signature of all things, and once again, like that swift bird rising from its ashes, the old ghost rises from the wreckage of this world to touch my semi-conscious life. Poetry, Dufu says, that will last 1,000 generations comes only as an unappreciated life is passed. I lay aside the book and rub my weary eyes just as Bojui did, reading Yuan Zhen on his boat by candlelight 1,000 years ago. I sit motionless in the motionless night while mist deepens and the whole house cools. And I listen to your breath and measure it against this slow, insistent tolling of our flesh.
Delia Rexroth, under your ill-kempt yellow roses, Delia, today you are younger than your son. 2.5 decades, and family monuments sagged askew, and he overtook your half a life. On the other side of the country, near the willows by the slow river, deep in the earth the white ribs retain the curve of your fervent, careful breast, the fine skull, the ardor of your brain, and in the fingers the memory of Chopin Etude, and in the feet slow waltzes and champagne two-step sleep, and the white full moon of midsummer that you watched awake all at last night, watch as history fill the deserts and oceans with corpses once again, and looks in the east window at me as I move past you to middle age and knowledge, past your agony and waste.
One day in late summer, One day in late summer in the early 90s, I had lunch with my old friend Jack Hogan, ex-Longshore Union worker and activist of San Francisco, at a restaurant in my small Sierra town. The owner had recently bought and torn down the adjoining brick building, which had been, in its time, a second-hand bookstore. Three R's, run by a puckish ex-professor. Our lunch table in the patio was right where his counter had been. Jack was married to my sister once. We all hung out in North Beach back in the 50s, but now he lives in Mexico. This present moment that lives on to become long ago. 1994.
Gary Snyder, One Day in Late Summer, from his book Danger on Peaks. And that is a hyben, a form Snyder really did not use until this 2005 book, very late in his career. Maybe it's an Americanized version of Bashō's hybrid form, so changes on changes. This is the PoJo Show, a micro edition in remembrance of poet Sam Hamill. In thinking about selecting this list of poems, I was drawn to a kind of elegiac mode. I chose to play Snyder since he was an important influence and peer of Hamill, and this poem because it reflects time's passage in this lunch with his sister's ex-husband, his sister for whom there's also an elegy in this same collection, and his thoughts on North Beach in the 1950s, that fertile period many years ago when so many writers and artists were creating a renaissance in San Francisco. We also heard Kenneth Rexroth, an even more important influence on Hamill, who went on to edit several collections of Rexroth's work. The poem was called Delia Rexroth, and it's an elegy for his mother, so I paired his reading with the first movement of Lou Harrison's Fourth Symphony, subtitled The Elegiac, which premiered in 1975. The composer's datebook notes that, quote, the intensely personal tone of this elegiac symphony was prompted by the death of Harrison's mother, which was followed by the death of his close friend, the iconoclastic American composer and instrument inventor, Harry Partch. The symphony's first movement is titled Tears of the Angel Israfel, the angel of music in Islamic lore, and the score also bears two inscriptions. The first reads, Epicurus said of death, where death is, we are not. Where we are, death is not. Therefore, death is nothing to us. The second inscription is a quote from Horace, bitter sorrows will grow milder with music. And so I selected a poem on a similar theme from Hamill. True Illumination is Habitude, which pays homage to Kenneth Rexroth and meditates on death and loss. The section of Hamill's translation of Bashō's Narrow Road to the Interior is, naturally, about travel, but even in this inaugural piece, in a work focused on forward movement and the future, there's still this intersection with the past in the line, sun and moon are eternal travelers. There's an intersection with aging in the line of old age leading a tired horse into the years. And even with death in the line, from the earliest times, there have always been some who perished along the road. So, quite a way to start a long journey. Shifting subjects slightly, that particular line is endnoted by Hamill. So I'd like to reread those lines with their footnotes, both to touch at least a little on his scholarship and to maybe question or complicate a frequent characterization of haiku and Asian poetry. And for an example of that, the blurb on the back of this Shambhala publication edition of Narrow Road says that Bashō, quote, elevated the haiku to an art form of utter simplicity and intense spiritual beauty. I think that really epitomizes the way this literature is often described. So, first let me give the lines again and their notes. The first line of the piece, and of the book as a whole, is, "The moon and sun are eternal travelers." Hamill's note for this says, "This line echoes the famous preface to a poem, Peach Garden Banquet on a Spring Night, by the Tang Dynasty poet Li Po." Another line that is in noted, "From the earliest times, there have always been some who perished along the road." Hamill's endnote says of this, "Bashō is thinking here of the Tang poet Du Fu and the wandering monk Saigyō." And then finally, the haiku at the end of this first haibun, "Even this grass hut may be transformed into a dollhouse." That is endnoted. "Doll's house" refers to Hina Matsuri, girls' festival, comparing his tiny thatched hut to his patron's mansion. The takeaway that I get from these various notes is not from anything specific to the notes themselves, but to the very idea of them. And to comment on that, I'd like to quote from a book on haiku by Hiroaki Sato. He writes, "The suggestion that the act of composing haiku is an almost unconscious one, and that witticism is nearly absent in this literary genre, would have startled Bashō, the first poet most people think of when the word haiku is mentioned. This I say not because of the trite observation that virtually no literary endeavor can be unconscious, save automatic writing. Rather, haiku during Bashō's days was occasional verse par excellence, or what Mallarmé called vers de circonstance." And by explanation, he goes on, "The term occasional verse is not used often these days, but the poem Maya Angelou composed for and recited at President Bill Clinton's inauguration is an occasional poem. So is Greetings, Friends, which Roger Angel annually composes for the end-of-the-year issue of The New Yorker. The latter, as you know, attempts to incorporate as many personal names in the news as is manageable in, quote, airy coils of rhyme. The poem last year, for example, had two lines, Harris Wofford, Kirkpatrick Sale, Harrison Ford, and Pauline Kael," end of quote. My conclusion here is that haiku and haibun and Asian literature as a whole is elusive. It alludes to things. It is intertextual. It uses a symbolic code as complex as Pilgrim's Progress or The Rape of the Lock. So I think the descriptions of it as, quote, utterly simple, intuitive, even unconscious, are inadequate. And one of the great contributions to our understanding of these poetries is Sam Hamill's scholarship, just one of his many great legacies. Thank you, Sam, and thank you for listening. Until next time, speak freely.